In a few minutes, we'll be starting. However, we should kindly... And so this afternoon, one of his passions, which is legacy and nation building, we'll be having a conversation on lasting legacies. This will involve a keynote address and a panel conversation. We hope that you'll be a part of the conversation fully. We'll have time for questions, comments, and hopefully a response from our distinguished panel of speakers. Our keynote speaker this afternoon is none other than His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Ebele Azikiwe Jonathan, GCFR, GCON. We look forward to hearing his insightful intake on today's topic. Our panelists include Mr. Tonya Cole, Mr. Otto Rondam, Dr. Obi Ezekwesili, and Bishop Feb Idahosa. And so I'm sure you'd agree with me that we have a packed morning and afternoon, and we look forward to a most productive day. Once more, thank you very much for coming. Please take your seats, and you're warmly welcome. Thank you very much for joining the Okunbo family at such a time as this. Thank you. Good morning, Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. We will soon be receiving the former president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and would like to say that at that point we will be starting the event shortly afterwards. Again, announcing the arrival of the former president of Nigeria and our keynote speaker for today, His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan, GCFR, GCON. Thank you. Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, announcing the arrival of His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Ebele Azikiwe Jonathan, GCFR, GCON, the 14th elected President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. He's here with the former First Lady, Her Excellency Dame Patience Jonathan. Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, in a moment we will be starting today's memorial lecture in honor of late Captain Ida Hosa Okunbo, referred to as Captain Hosa Okunbo. I'd like to welcome very specially and warmly all invited guests, dignitaries, family members who are here to honor and celebrate the life of a man who lived a great one indeed with lasting legacies. May I please ask that all invited guests kindly take their seats as we commence today's memorial lecture. Thank you. May I please crave your indulgence to wait for a few moments to allow family members to take their seats so that we can start in earnest. Thank you. Thank you very much. Again, with your permission, Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, would ask to wait for a few more minutes to allow family members, especially children of late Captain Hosa, to take their seats so that we can begin today's lecture. Thank you. Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, announcing the arrival of the Father of the Day, His Royal Majesty, Ogeame Atuwashe the Third, the Olu of Wori. He's here with his wife, Olori Atuwashe the Third. Also with us in the hall this morning, we have the Dane of Agbo Kingdom, Dane Kiagborekuzi the First. Thank you very much. Good morning, Your Excellencies. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, in a few minutes, we will be starting formally today's memorial lecture. You're welcome to the city of Abuja, being host of the Okunbo family, as they host today's memorial lecture in honor of late Captain Idahosa Okunbo. We thank you very much for spending your Saturday morning here with us. We are grateful and we look forward to a most productive conversation and lecture this morning. May I please kindly ask all our special guests to kindly take their seats as we will be starting now. Thank you very much. Again, Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, my name is Ayom Myro Ese, and it's an honor to serve as the host of the first memorial lecture honoring 1 year of the passing of late Captain Idahosa Okunbo. He's fondly referred to as Captain Hosa Okunbo, as some people like to call him Capitano or Captain. It's an honor for the family to put together this lecture as it is one of the lasting legacies of Captain Hosa. For many people who knew him, you would know that he was passionate about many things, amongst which his family, and of course, nation building. And so, as a way to honor his legacy, the family have put together a lecture to discuss lasting legacies, the key to Nigeria's development issues. Today, our discussants have been carefully selected as thought leaders, experts, and nation builders. We will be listening to a keynote speech, after which we'll have a panel conversation where we have an opportunity to have engaging conversations and hopefully prefer solutions to some of the issues highlighted this afternoon. Once more, on behalf of the Okunbo family, I'd like to thank you very much for coming and welcome you specially. To formally open today's meeting, may I please ask that we rise to take the national anthem. Before we take our seats, may I please crave your indulgence to kindly recite the second stanza of the Nigerian national anthem as a prayer. The words of that anthem are deep, and as we open today's meeting, it's important that we speak them and we sing with attention to the words as we decree it. The second stanza of the national anthem.
Thank you.
we take our seats, a final assignment so that we don't trouble you any further. Thank you very much for reciting the national anthem and singing with passion and meaning the second stanza as a prayer. At this point, we'd like to take a moment of silence in honor of the man for whom and in whose honor we are gathered this morning. And so we'd like to take a moment of silence for Captain Idahosa Okunbo. Thank you very much. May the soul of Captain Hosa Okunbo continue to rest in peace and the souls of the faithful departed. Thank you very much. May please take your seats. Before we proceed, kindly permit me to honor and acknowledge some of our special guests here this afternoon, this morning. We do not take it for granted that of all the things you could be doing this morning, a Saturday morning, you've decided to take out time to spend with the Okunbos to honor the legacy of Captain Hosa Okunbo. And so for the next few hours, we promise that every single time spent with us here would be indeed productive, impactful, and insightful. Today, we'd like to acknowledge and recognize the presence of the 14th elected President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Ebele Azikiwe Jonathan, GCFR, GCON. Thank you very much, sir. He also doubles as our keynote speaker for today's lecture. He's here with his wife, the former First Lady of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Her Excellency Dame Patience Jonathan. I'd also like to acknowledge the presence of the Father of the Day, His Royal Majesty, Ogyame Atuwase III, the Olu of Wari. Ogyame Suo. Also with us this morning, we have the presence of another royal father, the Dane of Agbor Kingdom, Dane Kiagborekuzi I. Today, His Excellency, Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan, hasn't come alone. He's come with a contingent, and I'd like to recognize and honor them. I'd like to recognize the presence of Chief Mike Ogyadome, former Chief of Staff to the President. I'd also like to recognize Honorable Ishaka Bawa, former Chief Whip of the House of Representatives. Also with us, we have Honorable Azibaola Omekwe, former member of the Bayelsa State House of Assembly. We also have present with us our discussants later in the day, panelists Dr. Obi Ezekwesili, two-time former minister of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. I know it's a very serious and formal event. However, I believe that we could be a bit more generous with our applause. So thank you very much for honoring all our invited guests. We are really grateful, and as a sign of appreciation, we want to really honor them with a sound applause. Thank you. Also joining the discussants this afternoon, we have a politician and co-founder, Sahara Group, Mr. Tonye Cole. We also have joining the discussants this afternoon, founder Slum to School Nigeria, Mr. Otto Orondam. And also one of the discussants, we have Bishop Feb Idahosa. Bishop Dr. Feb Idahosa. He's here with his beautiful wife, Pastor Lori Idahosa. In the course of the event, we would certainly be honoring our guests who are here. And so if your name isn't mentioned at this point, just wait a little bit longer. We will ensure that we get round to acknowledge you. On behalf of the Okunbo family, we're really honored that you've taken time to be with us here, and we cannot but celebrate and honor you here this afternoon. And so I'd like to also recognize and celebrate members of the Okunbo family present. We start with the senior members, brothers of Captain Hosa Okunbo. Mr. Kingsley Okunbo is here. I know sometimes we don't know how to clap for dignitaries, but when it comes to family members, we can be a bit more enthusiastic with our applause. And so please let us really honor. Today is a good day. It isn't often that a man passes away and there's things to be spoken about him or a legacy he's left behind. Captain Hosa Okunbo has left a strong legacy, lasting legacy. And so today, even though we miss him terribly, we can celebrate the life of a man well lived. And so today we hope that as we speak and we have conversations, we'll remember that a man once was with us who was passionate about the very things that we speak about today. And so that in itself should give us reason to celebrate. And so I'd like to also recognize some of his other brothers here, Mr. Dandison Okunbo. We're doing better. It's getting better. Thank you very much. Also, Mr. Morrison Okunbo. And Mr. Bright Okunbo. Eleron had acknowledged our royal father for today. However, I decided to keep the next person I'll be acknowledging until now because she plays a double role here today. She isn't just the wife of the Olu of Wari. She's also the daughter of Captain Hosa Okunbo, one of whom he was really proud of. And so let's celebrate Olori Atuwase III. Her Royal Majesty, Olori Atuwase III. Thank you. She deserves a double applause. Now, one of the biggest or deepest legacies a man could leave behind are the seeds he's left, his children. And so I'd like to honor and acknowledge all the children of Captain Hosa Okunbo. Some are present here today, whilst others are joining us virtually, unfortunately not able to be here physically. And so I'd like to recognize Miss Deborah Okunbo. I'd like to recognize Mr. Osaon Okunbo. Thank you. Also here is Mrs. Adesua Okunbo Rhodes. She's here with her husband, who's also a son of Captain Hosa, Mr. Nicholas Rhodes. We have Miss Osareme Okunbo. Osaru Okunbo. Ogogo Okunbo, Omosede Okunbo, Nosa Okunbo, Esohe Okunbo, Ryan Okunbo, and Brian Okunbo. Also present here, we have the mother of Olori Atuwase III, Mrs. Evelyn Okunbo. Still to join us, we have Ms. Tosan Ejo. Thank you very much. We would spend considerable amount of time honoring people and recognizing people because indeed we have a distinguished set of guests in this room. However, may I please crave your indulgence to move along with the program by celebrating and honoring all invited guests, special and close to the hearts of the Okunbo family. Thank you very much. We might not be able to mention name by name or by designation, but we do understand that you will indulge us at this point. Thank you very much for coming and to celebrate you. Can we please celebrate all invited guests, pastors, heads of ministries, heads of government parastatals, thank you very much for coming. We appreciate your time and we are grateful. At this point, to open up today's conversation and to give us a welcome remark on behalf of the family, please let's make welcome Mr. Osaon Okunbo.
Thank you. Standing on all existing protocol, I'd like to welcome everybody, and you're all duly recognized. Today is a special day. Today is actually not the day that marks the exact day that it was the transition. That was last Monday, which we held in Benin, and I want to take this opportunity once again to thank everybody that supported us and came to celebrate with us on Monday. Thank you very much. Today is also a very special day because myself and my siblings all decided it would be necessary for us to have a yearly memorial lecture in honor of my father to speak of things he held dear and to speak about his life in a way to immortalize his ideas, his values, and what he stood for. And that is the reason why we're here. And I would like to thank everybody for honoring the invite, the former president, President Goodluck Jonathan, and a father to me, and mommy, the former first lady, Dame Patience Jonathan. I truly appreciate you. Thank you very much. Also, I know I'm not allowed to say this, but he's my brother. And it's extremely dear to me and next to my heart. It's the father of the day, the Oluwa of Wari, Ogeyami Atuwase III. God bless you, my brother. Thank you so much. The mother of the house, my sister, Olori Atuwase III. God bless you. Thank you very much for being here. You're all duly welcome and recognized. Thank you all for being here to honor the life and the legacy of a dear father, an icon, Captain in the Hosa Wales Okunbo. We've gathered here today to celebrate the impacts of a man whose life continues to speak volumes till today. Not only are we celebrating a life well lived, but we are also setting the stage for continuity to ensure that the vision of this great hero is sustained. Rochelle Goodrich once wrote, "You are here to make a difference, to either improve the world or worsen it. And whether or not you consciously choose to, you will accomplish one or the other." Our father was a man on a mission. Every moment had to count for something, whether it was spending time with his family, reviewing business opportunities, or designing practical systems and solutions for adding value to the life of others within and outside the country. His legacy of impact will always be felt and celebrated. Long after today's event is over, it is my deepest desire that your hearts will be ignited with the vision of impact and lasting change. I hope the core values of service, sacrifice, philanthropy, and significance, which my father boldly embodied, would linger in your hearts and spur you on as you journey through life purposefully. Once again, I welcome you all to this memorial summit as we honor the life and impacts of an icon, a role model to me and to many others who will always be fondly remembered, Captain Dr. Ida Hosa Wales Okunbo. Thank you.
Can we please sustain the applause until he takes his seat? A truly heartfelt and powerful way to open today's conversations. Welcome remarks by Mr. Osaon Okunbo, son of Captain Dr. Hosa Okunbo. And as he spoke, I couldn't but hear some of the words that resonate with every one of us when we think of Captain. An icon, a man who lived an impactful life that continues to speak, a great hero, a man on a mission, a man who left a legacy of impact. And that's why today we're speaking on legacies. We're speaking on the conversation or having the conversation on the key to Nigeria's development issues and ensuring that, as Mr. Okunbo said, we continue what Captain Hosa started. And in continuation of that, I'd like to invite on stage a man that Mr. Osawo Okunbo has described as not just a nation builder and leader, but a father to him. Please permit me, even though he needs no introduction, to do a proper introduction with a brief bio. He was born on the 20th of November, 1957 in Otuoke, Nigeria. He's a Nigerian zoologist and politician who served as vice president 2007 to 2010 and president from 2010 to 2015. He's of the Ijo ethnic group and a Christian, was born and raised in the region of the Niger Delta in what is now Bayelsa State. He attended Christian primary and secondary schools in the area and later attended the University of Port Harcourt, earning a BSc in zoology in 1981 and MSc in hydrobiology and fisheries biology in 1985 and a PhD in zoology in 1995. During his university education, he also taught at River State College of Education from 1983 until 1993. He then served as an assistant director at the Oil Mineral Producing Areas Development Commission, a now defunct government agency, from 1993 until 1998. We're honored to have in our midst and to give the keynote address for today an elder statesman in every sense of that word, a peacemaker, a bridge builder. Please let's make very welcome His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan, GCFR, GCON, the 14th elected president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
Please be seated. Let me sincerely appreciate all of you, my wife that came with me, and let me sincerely appreciate the royal father of the day, His Royal Majesty Ogyame Towase III, the Olu of Warri, and Her Majesty Lori Towase III, who is the daughter of the person we are remembering today. We have also other traditional rulers, very senior citizens that have been introduced. Let me not bore your ears. It's an interesting day, and I really love the topic that we are going to discuss. I'm not going to present any scholarly paper, but I'm quite pleased that the list of those who will discuss, those who will sit here to interrogate the topic, not necessarily the paper, are intellectuals. My duty is just to raise some issues about the topic, fly some kites, and let the intellectuals come and discuss. Because I believe clearly, and in society, I love the topic. We should think about legacies of individuals, legacy of a nation. And in fact, this morning, before at about 10 a.m., I got a text from Nairobi, from Kenya. I just returned last night from Kenya, where I went there to observe their elections, and sent a text that 7 ladies have won governorship positions. 7. Ladies have won governorship positions. And that the top 2 candidates running for the presidency, one former Prime Minister Odinga and the serving Vice President Ruto, they are running neck to neck. So any of them can be president. Up to this time, nobody knows who will win. For Odinga, the running mate, who will be the next vice president, if he wins, is the lady, the former attorney general, the former justice minister of the country. So I started asking myself, when will we elect female governors in Nigeria? I believe somebody have left a legacy at a particular time in their political evolution. somebody has done something. So I'm going to look through about a little bit about our political journey as a nation and try to find out the legacies that were left behind. Sometimes may be bitter, sometimes could be tasty, but they leave legacies of unity in this country or legacies of division in this country. I will draw examples from Tanzania at the inception of their political evolution, what Nyerere did to consolidate the politics of Tanzania. We will also look at what Nkrumah did in his leadership philosophy that led to the consolidation of Ghana. Of course, in Nigeria now, you can listen, intellectuals will tell you, oh, Nigeria is not a nation. There is always the emphasis of ethnic nationalities in Nigeria. There's so many countries are built of different nationalities. You hardly see an intellectual from Ghana talking about Ghana is not a nation, Ghana is not a nation. But here we celebrate. So till today, we've not been able to move from ethnic nationalities to a country. And we believe more in our ethnic nationalities. Is that what is our problem, or there are some other issues? I think we'll listen to those who interrogate this topic. So I thank the Hosa Okunbo family for inviting me to this one-year memorial summit in honor of my friend, late Captain Dr. Hidahosa Wells Okunbo. It is sad to note that 1 year has gone by since the passing of your patriarch, Captain Okunbo, who was indeed my friend. He was a great industrialist who contributed considerably to the growth of our nation through hard work, discipline, and perseverance. He will continue to be remembered by many, not only in his family and community, but across the nation because of the impactful friendship and relationships he cultivated while alive. I am pleased to be speaking today on the topic, lasting legacy, key to Nigeria's development issues, because of its implication for developing nations, especially for our dear country, Nigeria. I don't usually give definitions, but for this, let me start unusually by looking at the ordinary meaning of legacy. According to the Oxford Advanced Learner's Dictionary, legacy refers to money or property that is given to you by somebody when he or she dies. It can also be defined as something that somebody has done successfully and that has positive effect on people that are associated with that person. This means that its application can be narrowed down to two key areas, the tangible and the intangible. On the one hand, legacy aggregates the estates left to someone by a dead relative. On the other hand, it could refer to a positive deeds, conducts, and actions that combine to define an individual from which relatives could draw an advantage from. For example, especially in the Western world, somebody who applied to be admitted in a university could be easily admitted because probably the father or the mother passed through that university and set good records. The person is still alive, but because of the records of that person, the son or a cousin or a nephew bearing the same name would just be admitted because of what the other person has done. It may not necessarily be in material, but in conduct and so on. If you look at our political evolution, we talk about development. Yes, of course, for you to develop, you must have a functional, focused government based on clear developmental philosophy and vision. For any nation to develop, there must be a political stability. I believe that there will be no meaningful advancement without good governance, which provides the atmosphere for citizens to realize their full potential based on their vision and the vision of their leaders. At independence in 1960, the colonial masters handed over a country that was a bit balkanized. Maybe that is the bane of Nigeria. But let me even go back to the amalgamation of 1914. I remember I was a bit lucky as a president. I celebrated the 50 years of our independence. I was also lucky to celebrate the centenary of amalgamation, 100 years of the existence of Nigeria. And a number of issues came up, because when we are to celebrate the centenary, so many people believe that we had no reason to celebrate the centenary, because that we have not gained anything from the amalgamation. And I think those are the sentiments that are still controlling us today. So we believe that along the line, proper legacies were not left behind for the younger people. When, after the amalgamation, of course, we are governed under regional, northern region, western region, eastern region, later midwestern region. And from that time till now, we see a kind of drag, a kind of fight between all these regions struggling to control the affairs of the nation. Of course, when the military took over, when Gowon became a head of state, wanted to change that regional structure of conflict to a unitary system of government by creating 12 states to dilute the effect of the regions. I'm not condemning the issue of regions, and I must emphasize that. Probably if Nigeria has followed that regional development up to today, this country would have been better off. If you look at what happened in the Western region, for example, where Ewo came up with his policy of free education. Education is one key thing that you can use to unite people and advance people. Nkrumah did it in Ghana in 1961 when he came up with his policy of free primary education. Then primary education was a big deal then, as in the 60s. And his political party used that to advance their political philosophy and used that to galvanize the unity in Ghana. So education is key. You look at what Ewo did, of course, the University of Ibadan, First Television, and so on. So in fact, the Southwest was regarded as one of the most developed parts of Africa then. So I believe if we had been allowed to continue that way, and probably the major regions have that kind of peer review, looking at what others are doing, you want to also do better, the country would have been better off. Even probably the security we are suffering today, we wouldn't have. But somehow the military took over and wanted a unitary system. They wanted the country to go in one direction. They tried their best, but I believe that there was no clear philosophy that guided them in the attempt to unify the country. No clear vision. They died. I remember, of course, that the NYC was set up to make sure that young Nigerians serve in all parts of the country after graduation. But the NYC, if you compare that to what Nkrumah did, what he called the Ghana Young Pioneer Movement, that was a movement. NYC, you go after the 12 months of service, you look for a job and you forget about everything. But what Nkrumah did to make sure that he brought Ghana with different tribes together, so the problem of tribe and religion, he set up the Ghana Young Pioneer Movement. And that was a movement. It's not just about a one-year program to galvanize unity. We never had that experience in Nigeria. If you take a place like Tanzania, at inception of their political evolution, Julius Nyerere, one thing he did was that he looked at Tanzania and said, look, there are too many languages and tribes in this country. There are two major religions, Christianity and Islam, and other minor ones. And if you allowed multi-party as at that time, some political parties will toe religious lines, some will toe ethnic lines, and will create problems for the unity of Tanzania. And he advocated for a one-party system. Today, you cannot talk about one-party system because actually multi-party is the best. But at the inception of the country, somebody had a vision and a vision to unite his people. And has to adopt methods to bring that unity first. And there are a number of things he did, but two have been celebrated. The first and foremost, of course, Tanzania is an Anglophone, or colonized by the British people. So English is their lingua franca. But then they created another lingua franca. Luckily for them, which we are not that lucky in Nigeria. Swahili is a pan-East African language. So many countries in East Africa speak Swahili. So we promoted Swahili and made sure that Swahili was taught in all the primary schools and secondary schools Even in their textbooks were written in Swahili. So Mileda, you go through their primary schools, even if you are not from the tribe that actually speaks Swahili, by the time you go through the primary school, you start speaking Swahili. So that become the dominant indigenous language that everybody believed. So that reduced the tongue. Then, of course, the one-party system. Of course, later now they have changed to multi-party. Because himself, he did that when he was still alive, and he believed that, yes, by now we should move from one party to multi-party. That is the trend of the world. So you begin to ask yourself, in our system, what happened along our political evolution? What happened? If you care to read about the statements accredited some of our political leaders in the 60s, which I will not mention names, I hardly see somebody with a core nationalist view because of the amalgamation and the regional evolution. People were more interested in their regions. And that is why most of our intellectuals, even today, will celebrate the fact that, oh, Nigeria is not a nation. Yes, how many countries that have, maybe countries like India and few countries that you have one nationality forming the country. Most other countries, especially in Africa, have different tribes, different languages. But you hardly hear people talking about this, our country is not a nation. In Nigeria, it is a big thing for professors to tell you that Nigeria is not a nation. It's like a big academic achievement. So we've not really migrated from our ethnic nationality interests to see the country as one, but we're together. So I believe, along the line, the necessary legacies were not laid for us. And now we are festing in that. In fact, if you look at the Nigerian political evolution now, the issue of religion is becoming so important, so significant. Tribe becomes so significant. And you begin to say, is that the way we can develop our nation? If we, the current politicians, are unable to change the dynamics and begin to sow seed that will grow, will blossom, and rebuild this country. Like the common saying that as a leader is to plant trees that you may not necessarily enjoy the shade, but your children and grandchildren will enjoy that. Our political leaders should begin to think again. If we must stay together as a nation, then leaders, political leaders, must leave legacies of unity. If we unite, we'll grow better, we'll develop better. If we continue with the kind of divisions we have, it will not be too good for us. I remember what the ancient Greeks looked at human population and said that human population is categorized into three basic groups: the idiots, the tribesmen, and the citizens. And their definition of idiots are not people who have weak thinking, not the kind of idiot we see. It have nothing to do with their cranial capacities. They are normal human beings, could have first class in the universities. But they are selfish, they think more of themselves than others. Self-centered human beings. Everything is self. And the Greeks called those people idiots. Then the people they call tribesmen, it's not that you belong to a tribe. It's a good thing to belong to a tribe. You must belong to a tribe as a human being. But when you promote your tribal interests above everything else, then they call you as a tribesman, yes, like a second-class person. You're not valued that much. And they call the real people the citizens. Not the citizens of a nation. All of us are citizens of Nigeria or citizens of a country. But then, these are the people that, whatever they are doing, they consider the effect of what they are doing to their neighbor. Even if they are driving on the road, they are careful about the other person using the road, the other motorists, the cyclists, those who are trekking. Whatever they are doing, they think about the national interest, the interests of the people around them. If they are playing their music for any program, they will not play their music to make people deaf. They consider the effect of whatever they are doing. Those are the people the Greeks then call citizens. People must, at one time or the other, in the evolution of their country, plant seeds, leave legacies that can lead to the unity and development of that country. And it's not just the political leadership at the center. In most cases, when we discuss in Nigeria, people always think about the central government, the president, National Assembly, and so on. It's not only president. If you're a governor, what legacies are you going to leave behind that the next generation will remember you for? If you're a council chairman, what legacies will you leave behind that you'll be remembered for? Even if you're the paramount ruler, we have kings here, top kings here with us. They will all want to leave legacies because they inherited a stool that was left up to them by an ancestor who left that legacy. So on their own, at the time of death, what legacy will you leave behind as a tradition, a paramount ruler of a community or a king of a kingdom? Even if you're a priest, you're a religious person, what legacy will you leave behind for your followers? Will you leave a legacy of leading 1,000 people to drink poison and die that they are going to heaven? So everybody, and I always believe that leadership starts from the home. At the home, at our homes, what legacy have we left behind for others? And today we are here because somebody, Captain Hosa Okunbo, left legacies as an individual. Because as at individual family level, we must also leave legacies. As a businessman, one thing I know that endeared him to people across different social status was his warmth, openness, and generosity. If he was not a pleasant and sociable fellow, probably most of us here wouldn't have been here. Probably I wouldn't have been here too. But because this man left a legacy, he was an entrepreneur who carved a niche for himself by investing in people and in those businesses that made significant impact in the Nigerian economy and the lives of the people. Captain lived a life of philanthropy. Although he achieved so much as a businessman and invested in big enterprises, he will perhaps be remembered more for his large heart, spirit of philanthropy, and love for the needy. One of his legacies that will continue to endure is that he nurtured and mentored many to become responsible members of the society, including his own children, who he gave the best guidance in character and in learning. Yeah. I'm not surprised that they have continued in the family tradition by showing good examples in business, philanthropy, and friendship. As I end, let me state that there is no better way to enunciate the essence of legacy of an individual, than individual or a group of individuals, than for us to remember the words of one of the Christian hymns titled "Fading Away Like a Star of the Morning."
Fading away like the stars in the morning, losing their light in the glorious sun. Thus would we pass from the earth and its toiling, only remembered by what we have done. Only remembered, only remembered, only remembered by what we have done. Thus just would we pass from the earth and its toiling, only remembered by what we have done.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for the excellent note speech and a great way to set the tone for today's lecture. Can we one more time honor His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan, former President of Nigeria, for that thought-provoking call to action in his keynote address. A few highlights as he spoke and something for us to take away. Today's lecture is not supposed to be just a talk shop. It's a call to action for us to go away with the topic on lasting legacies, a key to Nigeria's development issues, and seeing how we can individually and collectively play a role in ensuring that we achieve development in Nigeria and that we have legacies that are passed on from one generation to another. And so as he spoke, he talked about, or he drew lessons from the lives of two exceptional leaders in Africa, Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana and Julius Nyerere of Tanzania. Being a president himself, a former president himself, it was important to draw lessons from these men who led their countries in such a way that we have stories and lessons to glean from them and templates to work with. He also hemmed on the importance of political stability and good governance as being vehicles to nation thriving. Also, talking about the difference between movement and programs. So it's not enough to have programs that would last temporarily, but movements that will last a lifetime. So beyond just asking people to move from nation to nation, it also speaks to sustainability, which indeed is part of what we're talking about today in terms of legacy. Also, just pushing the thought of core nationalistic view as a conversation that we must have in Nigeria if we're to move forward, so that no one is first identifying as being from a particular tribe, but first and foremost being Nigerian. And so perhaps the question to ask everyone here this afternoon is, when you think of yourself as Nigerian, what comes to mind first? Do you first think about the fact that you're Yoruba, or from Warri, or from Benin? Or do you think of yourself first as being Nigerian and upholding the beauty and honor of this great nation? That's something to think about. And of course, borrowing from the quotes by a Nigerian novelist, Idowu Koyenikan, saying, even though our time in this life is temporary, if we live well enough, our legacy will last forever. It was important that he ended on the note on which he did, by highlighting some of Captain Hosa Okunbo's legacies, chief of which, as we've mentioned, are his children. And you don't need to look too far. When you look around and see the quality and depth of his children, you would know that he was a man who was indeed committed to legacies. One more time, can we celebrate for the keynote address, His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan. Thank you very much, sir. And having said that, he set a fantastic tone for our next conversation, which is the panel discussion. Now, this is going to take the words that have been spoken and delivered during the keynote and breaking it down. He spoke about the role that that family have, the role that the religious organizations have, the role that the private sector has, the role that politicians have. And we have each of them represented on the panel this afternoon. And so I'm going to invite them on stage and then invite the moderator of today's panel conversation. And so please, when I invite them on stage, I know we've been doing fantastic so well, I'd like you to please encourage and just really celebrate and honor them as they come on stage. The first person I'll be introducing was born on the 28th of April, 1963. She's an economic policy expert and advocate for transparency, accountability, good governance, and human capital development. She's a humanitarian and an activist. She is a former vice president for the World Bank's Africa region, co-founder and founding director of Transparency International, co-founder of the hashtag Bring Back Our Girls movement, and has served twice as federal minister in Nigeria. She's also the founder of hashtag Fix Politics Initiative, a research-based citizen-led initiative, the School of Politics, Policy and Governance, SPPG, and Human Capital Africa. A woman who is truly committed to nation building. Let's make very welcome Dr. Obi Ezekwesili. You're welcome, ma'am. Thank you very much. The next panelist was born on the 11th of January 1967 in Port Harcourt, Rivers State. He attended All Saints Church School in Ibadan and Corona School, Victoria Island, Lagos. He then went to King's College Lagos and King's School Ely, Cambridgeshire, England. He also attended the University of Lagos, graduating with a BS and BArch Merit Honours in Architecture in 1990, after which he proceeded to Osun State for his National Youth Service Corps. He's an alumnus of Harvard Business School's Advanced Management Program, Fellow Blavatnik School of Government, Oxford, and member National Institute for Policy and Strategic Studies Senior Executive Course, SEC 43, Kuru, Jos, Nigeria. He's also co-founder of Sahara Group, an energy conglomerate founded in 1996. Various national assignments, including Governing Council, Nigerian Chamber of Shipping Honorary Senior Advisor on Energy, Rivers State Government from 2009 to 2011, Member Nigerian Development Forum, NDF, in 2007. Member National Committee on Job Creation, NCJC, 2010. Chairman Greater Port Harcourt Development Authority, 2013 to 2016. Chairman Presidential Council Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, 2017. Advisory Board, the Nigeria Blueprint, Imagine the Future, 2021, chaired by Vice President, His Excellency, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, SANGCFR. A man whose qualifications, expertise, and business acumen is one to certainly be celebrated. Please let's make very welcome our second panelist for today, Ms. Tonya Cole. I think it's also worthy of note that he's also a gubernatorial aspirant in River State, Port Harcourt. In Port Harcourt, River State, or River State and Port Harcourt. A round of applause, please, one more time, Mr. Tonya Cole. Our next speaker has a truly applause-worthy profile. He's a social entrepreneur, development consultant, and community organizer with over 15 years' experience working across the private, civil society, and public sectors. In 2012, following the increasing number of out-of-school children, he founded Slum to School Africa to support the education of underserved children in slums and hard-to-reach communities. And since inception, Slum to School has grown to become one of Africa's leading volunteer-driven developmental organization. He has worked with over 15,400 volunteers, volunteer-driven developmental organizations. He has worked with scholarships and various development support to over 627,450 children from 950 communities in Nigeria. He has built various early childhood development centers, adopted public schools, built e-libraries, health centers, STEM and innovation labs, which are serving thousands of children across Nigeria. Please let's make a welcome to join the panel, the founder, Slum to School Africa, Orondam Otto. And finally, our next panelist is a man who is accomplished not just in the private sector, in the education sector, but also in religious circles. He's popularly referred to as Bishop Feb, a prominent minister of the gospel, professional educator, and a reputable entrepreneur. He holds a Bachelor of Science in Biology and a Bachelor of Arts in Business Administration from Oral Roberts University, Tulsa, Oklahoma, United States of America. He also has a master's degree in public health and a doctoral degree in educational leadership from Oral Roberts University. He has been the president of the Benson Idahosa University since April 15, 1998, and his active work and hands-on experience in the educational sector spans over 20 years. He's the proprietor of Nathan American Academy, proprietor of the Benson Idahosa School of Basic and Applied Studies, the Vice President of All Nations for Christ Bible Institute International, and a member of the Board of Trustees for Oral Roberts University. Please let's make very welcome Bishop Dr. Faith Emmanuel Benson Idahosa II, popularly referred to as Bishop Feb Idahosa. And finally, to moderate today's panel session, she's someone else who needs no introduction. However, it would be remiss of me not to do a proper welcome to her as she steers the ship of this conversation. Our moderator for today's panel session is the founder and managing partner of Arua Capital Management, one of the few women-owned and led private equity funds in Africa. She's invested into untapped investment opportunities in West Africa in the small to lower and mid-market. She launched Arua Capital Management with her own money in Lagos in July 2019 and left the comfort of a six-figure salary in order to make an impact in society with her skills and track record. She's an entrepreneur, CEO, mother, investor, and women's empowerment advocate. In addition to all this, I believe one of her proudest achievements is certainly being the daughter of Captain Hosa Okunbo. Please let's make very welcome Mrs. Adesua Okunbo Rhodes. And just before I hand the mic to Mrs. Rhodes, Okunbo Rhodes, as she leads this conversation, whilst His Excellency was speaking, we received the former governor of Edo State, His Excellency Comrade Adams Osiomole.
Hello. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. We really appreciate the time that you've taken to be with us on a Saturday. I'm standing on all existing protocols. So as Ayo has said, we have quite a well-diversified panel today, panel by sector, panel by experience, who are all forging legacies in their own lines of work and spheres of influence. We'll be talking about how we can keep legacies alive and soaring long after the passing of the visionary, and how we can also leverage legacy for national development and changing the fortunes of our country. We've already done a round of introductions, so there's no need to do that. But I'd like to ask the panel individually, what does legacy mean to you? And I'd like to start with Mrs. Obi, please.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Excellent. Well, I would like to first perhaps rejoice with the family of the Okunbos for the opportunity to actually celebrate that. The legacy conversation is so appropriate because at the passing of one generation, that's when you frankly have to decide whether indeed there had been any intergenerational transmission of values. And so looking at Captain's children, I knew him because he hung around a lot of PDP people in the time that I was in government. And so I saw quite a bit of him within that circle. But I think that what distinguished him was his entrepreneurial capabilities and the fact that he maintained a sense of family values that enabled him to nurture all of you to the place where you are. And I must say that the reason that I could leave the Redeemed Camp early this morning in order to take the 6:30 flight so that I could be here is because of the Her Majesty the Atunwashe. I had to do it. When we established a program to focus on human capital issues on our continent, especially because current data shows that the continent is in deep crisis, and it has to do with some of the things that the former president, President Jonathan, was saying about society and the resilience of society. It's that 9 out of every 10 African children do not have the literacy and numeracy skills that 10-year-olds around the world have. That's a disaster. I mean, that's not even a disaster. That's an emergency. Because the research also shows that the lack of foundational literacy and numeracy skills by the time a child is 10 is a predictor of lifelong poverty. So we can, at the parachute level, be saying we want to tackle poverty, and we're not paying attention to the fact that the foundational skills of 9 children out of every 10 will remain poor until we correct it as a continent. We're not going anywhere. Why was this important for me? When we launched this program, we invited the Her Majesty, and within a turnaround time of 2 weeks, she actually made it her duty to show up in Abuja and to be one of the speakers. And I don't forget things like that because they are demonstration of what people value. If you show me what you value, I can decide whether I connect to it or not. And so legacy is being here because I saw in your sister someone who clearly was epitomizing the values that I subscribe to.
I'd like to go to Otto next, please. What does legacy mean to you?
Yeah, it's been a very emotional day, you know, just listening to the great words that have been shared. And it takes me back to growing up as a child, you know, and seeing that one of the greatest gifts that my dad passed on to us, I'm probably the youngest on this panel, and everyone on the panel had been involved in the work I do and my life even as a young person. And growing up, I remember very clearly that my dad said, even if I don't have food to eat, I must ensure that I give you good education. And when I remember the life of Captain, it's primarily what I see in this room. The great talents, the incredible presence of his children. And for me, growing up, visiting one of the communities where we started in 2011, when I was posted to Lagos for my National Youth Service, I went into the community, which many of us are very familiar with, called Makoko. And as a youth copper, for the first time, growing up in a family where I had literally everything I wanted. I saw children who never had food to eat, clothes to wear, and education. And for me, it was a shock. It was almost a traumatizing experience, because I'm like, how would this happen? How would this be a reality in what we call the mega city, the economic capital of a great country like Nigeria with incredible opportunities and potential? And I was working in the bank, and I kept asking myself every other day, what will it really be? What will my service really mean to this nation if at the end of my service here, we do not get these children into school? And so every other Thursday, I would go into that community and teach them, because that was my CDS day. I was about 23, 24. And I did that for a couple of weeks, but I realized that that was not enough. These children needed to be in a classroom. And after a couple of months, I was pushed, you know, by my spirit to quit my job in the bank and focus on trying to get partnerships and get volunteers and raise resources to get those kids into school. This was in 2012. And again, when I say everyone on this panel, it almost feels like a family, because Auntie Obi has been a huge part of the work we've done over the last 10 years. I call him Uncle Tonye. He's been a huge support. He's on the board. Bishop Feb has incredibly been a part of the work we do, and I will share that in a bit. In 2012, it was a huge decision, a very terrible decision that everyone felt I had made. My parents were like, we've invested so much in you. Why do you want to quit a great job like this to go into a community and help kids you have no connection with? But for me, it was not about legacy. It was about purpose. It was telling myself that if these kids do not have education before the end of my service, I would not find myself feeling fulfilled. We struggled. We raised funds. We got 114 children into school in 2012. And 10 years later, over 50% of those children are done with their secondary school. Two are at the back of this room because they're on scholarship here in Abuja. But that is not really the great story. What we did inspired thousands of volunteers. It inspired several organizations, over 300 organizations that we've partnered with, over 15,000 volunteers. Our impact has grown to over 600,000 children across this country. And for me, when I reflect on the experience and the opportunity I had as a child, legacy is paying it forward. And today we see that so many of those young kids, many of them, about five of them are done with the university, 15 are in the university, over 50 are done with secondary school. Thousands are across secondary schools. That's legacy, not just legacy for me, but legacy for them, because they are paying it forward. We have a lot of those kids who have gone back to their community to start raising another generation of young kids who are going into schools. And I feel it's important that at some point, every one of us in this nation, I loved the example that His Excellency gave. We all need to be citizens. If we want to build a nation that we will be proud of, we need to stop being tribesmen. We need to stop being idiots. We need to start being citizens. And being citizens mean living a life of legacy and standing up for those who do not have voices and those really who cannot pay us back. Thank you.
Thank you, Otto. Thank you very much. So I'm going to come on to Mr. Tony Cole. So you grew up under the guidance of a father who served the nation in his time. How did his life of service and legacy of leadership shape the man that you have become today?
There I was preparing to answer the question on legacy, and one comes about my father. Now I have to turn my head around. But Mr. President, my royal fathers, Gamesu, and everyone here, thank you for being here. You know, legacy starts, first of all, for me, with the name that you present to your children. If there's one thing that my father did, apart from education, is that he left a name. He left a name that went so far ahead of me that it began to open doors that I did not even know existed. A recent one was sitting down at the National Institute in Kuru. And one of the early lectures that I went to, the directing staff was talking about the people who formulated the policy that ended up building the school. And he mentioned my father's name, had no idea who I was, did not know my father, but he mentioned, he said, one of those great men that sat down and put this entire thing here is somebody called Patrick Daly Cole, that those were the men back in the days that held the civil service. And he was talking with passion about what the civil service used to be versus what it is today. He had no idea. I didn't say anything. It must have been about a month later that that's my direct himself. He suddenly dawned on him that, hang on, your name is Tony Patrick Cole. And the person I was talking about is Patrick Daly Cole. Says, is that your father? And I said, yes, it is. But I remembered again, this is one of many examples of sitting down in a room where the weight of an expectation that had already been put forward by somebody who just diligently served had opened doors and put responsibility to you to do what is right. And so for me, where my father made an impact is in the name. And then I remember, even as Mr. President was speaking, that then legacy is not about buildings, it's not about statues, it's not about billboards and posters. Legacy goes from one generation into another generation. And most times, when we think about what makes a difference in life, Mr. President never mentioned who was the richest man in Ghana at the time in 1960s, in 1950s. He did not mention who was the richest Tanzanian at the time. He didn't mention who was the biggest entrepreneur. And those were not the things that created the legacy moving forward. What he talked about were the names of people who transformed their nation by doing things and setting parameters for generations to come on. And that's exactly what this is. We have our royal father sitting here. He's sitting on a throne that people long before him had built legacy on, and that's why he's here today. And he's now carrying the weight of that office for his own generation and for his own children moving forward. The name that he leaves behind is what his children will benefit from. The name that Captain Hosa left behind is exactly what the family is living on today. For me, my father left a good name. Well, he's still alive, so he built a good name. I have that responsibility to carry that forward for my own children and for their children as well.
Thank you, Mr. Cole. That one really resonates with me because I remember telling my father that I don't need your money anymore. All I need is your name. And I took permission from my husband to leave Okunbo in my name for that reason. It opened so many doors and it continues to open so many doors. Bishop Feb. So Bishop Benson Idahosa of blessed memory undoubtedly left a global legacy behind. As his son, you have the huge responsibility of upholding that legacy. Has that been difficult? How's the journey been?
Thank you very much for the opportunity to share. I think I'll answer both questions, the first one and the second one, in the same answer, because they connect together. Tonya Cole mentioned something just now about the name, and then used the word weight. And I think that's, for many of us who come in that second generation or third generation, the big thing is the weight of the name. And that carries, that for me is part of the legacy. What is legacy to me? To me, legacy is, I heard a saying once that says you can count the number of seeds in an orange, but you cannot count the number of trees in an orange seed. And to me, I modified that to a mango and said, okay, you can count the number of seeds in a mango, that's just one. But the number of trees in that mango seed, you cannot count because that mango seed will give you 20, 30, 40 more trees that will come out of that one, because that one seed will give you one tree. In that tree will give you many, many more mangoes, which have many, many more seeds. And then those seeds will give you many, many more trees. So you cannot really count the number of trees in that one seed. Here's how this works with legacy. So with a legacy of people who have left a great name, like my father, Benton Idahosa, or like Captain Hosa Okunbo, we're here today, there were one seed. But when that seed is planted, the Bible talks about how if a seed does not die in the ground, it cannot truly be alive. That one seed then grows up. It gives you many, many more trees. In those trees are many, many more seeds. That's how legacy works. Because you see, one life will give you many lives. We have several children here today. And these children have many, many more seeds. You have an organization that's going to give funding to other people to help them start businesses. Otto has started Slum to School, which the students from Slum to School have come into our university. We give them scholarships, and then they're going out now, and they're going to do many more things. We're talking this morning about how we don't know what that one young lady who was coming to our school will do in the future. That's a legacy, because in the future, 10, 20 years from now, one day we'll all be dead. But the seed that she will do, she can help somebody else become something great. She might become a president like His Excellency here of the country, just from one seed. That is what legacy is. Now, has it been difficult for me? The answer, yes, it's been very difficult for me, because people look at me and say, and my brother here did the same thing, say, oh, can you fill your father's shoes? For me, it was very difficult, because for many years I was trying to be him. I would dress like him. I would try to wear his shoes, literally. I would try to, his friends would call on the phone. I would say, hello, Bishop. And I would try to speak in his voice. I would take his sermons and preach his exact same sermons. And one day God tapped me on the shoulder and said, stop trying to fill your father's shoes. I've given you your own shoes to fill. And so it shifted my focus to say, you know, I'm not going to try to wear his shoes. I need to find my own shoes. He's given me my own shoes. And my shoes will take me far, because the shoes he gave him took him to where he was. And so my shoes, when I put my feet in my shoes, they will take me to where God has said I should go to. And I want to say that to everyone who's a second generation child and legacy carrier, because the weight of the name is heavy, but that weight is what helps you get to where you are. It is said that we stand on the shoulders of those who have gone before us. And that's truly a blessing, to have a name like Okunbo, or a name like either Hosa that has gone before you. You can stand on that shoulder. And then from there, you can see far, and you can begin to take those mango seeds, the one seed, and plant more trees. That is what legacy is. And that's how you can become something great.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I know my brother was listening intently to that one. I'm going to come to Mrs. Obi. So we're going to now talk about legacy and impact in building national development. So in recent years, Nigeria has seen a massive exportation of human capital. The trend is more prevalent among the youth who are meant to sustain national development and pass their legacies on to the next generation. What structures can be put in place to maximize Nigeria's human capital and encourage nation building?
Well, I think that the good thing we have here is that in the earlier question, you saw how I had a deep dive into education. That's because it appalls me when I look at Africa's political class. It's a political class that has refused to learn from research. And that's painful, because what has happened is that failure has pigeonholed the continent into a vortex of an obsession for natural resources and the wealth that comes out of it. And the wealth that comes out of natural resources, in the case of African countries, whether it's Zambia with its copper, or it's Gabon that's now almost post-oil, because their oil endowment has shrunk to the lowest possible levels. Or it's DRC that's got both diamonds and everything you can imagine in between them. The same thing is the story. It has never translated into lasting capital. You could call lasting capital lasting legacy. The absence of lasting capital from the proceeds that come out of natural resources that you did not work for. It simply was a natural occurrence. It's a divine endowment. And the poor usage of it by political class of our continent is an indication that we really don't care about legacy. Let's not care about legacy. It's about my belly, myself, my life, my, you know, there is a complete forgetting of the biblical injunction. What does it profit a man or a woman to gain the whole world and then lose their souls? When you see the continent in desperate circumstances, it is the failure of a focus on what you just talked about. Because research has shown it. The progress of continents have been studied. No continent made it without a focus on human capital. It's not possible. The correlation between human capital and economic growth is there for all to see. If you cannot even understand it easily, technically, just look at a Japan or look at a Singapore and think of the absence of natural resources from these countries, but the absolute presence of serious and significant consistent investment in the people. The word citizen was used here today. When you consider your people citizens, your investment in them translates them from mere population to human capital. That's what happens. The model that has worked in many societies has been the model where education is put at the center of economic development. And by doing that, it ensures the basic concept of egalitarianism, that everyone should be included in purposeful pursuit of development. We have failed to do that, and that costs us too much. So for a system that would support this, you need first a political class that gets the consciousness that spending money from natural resources and thinking that's the end of life is a wrong paradigm, and that the only thing that would work is to have a consciousness of political leadership where the emphasis is on the citizens and the investment necessary to translate them appropriately.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Zobi. So I'm going to move now to Otto. So my father always said, to know where we are going, we must know where we are coming from. And while vision tells us where we're going, history tells us where we're coming from. And we heard from President Jonathan Goodluck Jonathan's remarks about, you know, going back into history and learning from Nkrumah and Nyerere. So my question to you is, we know that to preserve the history and legacy of a nation, educational system must be preserved. Over the past 10 years, slum to school, Africa has impacted over 600,000 children. How can we restore and preserve the legacy of quality education in Nigeria to contribute to national development?
That's a very loaded question. I think in 2019 and 2020, whilst a lot of the work we had done still gaining lots of very great visibility, international recognition, deep inside of me, I was feeling very frustrated and depressed. Because for every child we support, just like Dr. Obi has said, you have 9 other children who would never have that opportunity. When you walk the streets of Abuja, and I'm not speaking about, you know, the south or the west or the north, when you walk the streets of Abuja on a Monday morning, we all see children who are not in school. That's human capital being wasted. And each of those children has a potential, has the opportunity to be transformational agents, to be entrepreneurs, to be global, you know, thought leaders. And so there was just a lot of frustration, because it all rises and falls on the quality of policy that our government implements. It's not about philanthropy. It's not about charity. It's the responsibility of the government to ensure that every child in Nigeria, every child of this nation has quality education. And for me, there was a lot of frustration, and I felt it was important to actually go back to school. And thanks to lots of the, you know, like Bishop Febb said, and my dad used to tell us that a dwarf standing on the shoulder of a giant will see farther than the giant. You know, so I reached out and applied to go back and study at the Kennedy School, and I finished a mid-career master's in public administration and policy at the Harvard Kennedy School, where I realized that there are lots of opportunities for us as a nation to ensure that we implement the right policy. If Nigeria succeeds, the African continent will succeed. If Nigeria takes its rightful place, Black Americans and Blacks across the world will take their rightful places. We as a nation, we know for a fact that we are the largest Black nation on earth. And Nigerians excel across the world. Across the US, you see Nigerians who excel. Across some parts of the world where you have not even heard of, Nigerians are excelling. So why don't Nigerians excel back at home? What are we not doing right? And so it's important for all of us to be giants. It's important for all of us to go out and stand so that the young ones who do not have that opportunity, and there are so many of them, we say 10 million today, sometimes we say 13 million, tomorrow is 18 million, but we know that this data is incorrect. We have millions of Nigerian children who do not have the opportunity to get the kind of education many of us in this room have got. And so the quality of policies that we pass, the quality of leaders that we appoint, it's important to have young people get into government as well. And it's not just about, you know, the political parties. I think every one of us can be part of the change we want to see in our local communities, in our little way. It's a collective effort from every one of us. And I feel that what we've been doing is basically building on the strengths of the people we have around our community. The network we have. And this is also an invitation to every one of us to say we can work together. We can build a strong system. We can build stronger coalitions to ensure that we can hold our government accountable. We could be part of the government as well. And we can build a nation that we will all be proud to call our home. Thank you.
Thank you, Otto. So I'm going to come to you now, Mr. Cole. So Miles Monroe also said that success without a successor is a failure. As an accomplished energy magnate and philanthropist, can you please share with us some effective strategies on identifying successors, building them, and passing on legacies accurately?
Seem to get all the tough questions. Okay, you know, first of all, for me, the transition from an entrepreneur who had built a company from when I was 27, 28, through 23 years of doing that, and then transiting so completely into politics, was something that needed careful planning and needed to ensure that the day I turned away from that and moved on, that the company would survive. Now, it was important. So what were the three things that I took away from that exercise? The first is that you must have the right partners. I'd built a company where three of us had built this company. If one was going to leave and move into another venture, then the DNA that you had put together and how you had built it together was very important to see that it survives an exit. My exit into politics was certain that I had to focus 100% on the politics and not on the business again, which meant that the business had to survive. So the first thing is that you must have the right partners. The second aspect of it was that we had to look and see generational changes even within the business. In identifying this, you know that life continues to change and people change. And so we began to look as a company as to how we can get younger people in, but we knew that it was important that they went with us where we went. And so we started the process back then of direct reverse mentoring. We were learning from them and they were learning from us. And so For six, it started off with a six-month program. I would take two young people with me wherever I went. They went to meetings I went to, sat down in everywhere I went. Didn't matter whether we were with presidents or were with ministers, they were there with us. Mr. President will recall that many times we were with him, with younger people in the room, and they accorded us that because what it showed them was how you begin to interact at different levels. And so that transition of giving the younger generation confidence to go with you, see what you see, do what you do is very important. So for legacy, you need to also impact your DNA into another generation. So the first one, have the right partners. The second one, impart your DNA into the next generation. Very, very important that you do that. And then the third one, don't be afraid of mistakes. Sincerely, everybody makes mistakes. We make mistakes, they make mistakes, and all of that. But when you're building legacy, you must be courageous enough to face things that everybody else will run away from. And you must be courageous enough. So you must stand and face what others will say do not do. Our entire business was facing things that they said was impossible. They said only white men could do our business. So we said, if that's the case, we will do it. And so we did it. They said to us that Nigerians were not intelligent enough to raise the kind of money that was needed to do that business. I said, really? Okay, so we're intelligent enough, we will raise the money and we started to do it. They said to us that we could not open businesses, that Nigerians were all fraudulent, and so they could not open businesses in different countries. And so we decided that we would go into Geneva, we would go into Dubai, we would go into Singapore, we'll go all over the world and open businesses and show that Nigerians can do it. Essentially, we were doing things that everybody said was impossible. And now I'm on another journey. And they said, people like you cannot survive in politics. I said, really? So we go into politics and we'll show them that people like me can survive in politics. And so the point about legacy is that you must live what you talk. Be what you say, do it. What you believe in, act it. And when you carry people along, make sure that they follow you all the way to where you're going.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to come to you now, Bishop Feb. So often there seems to be a miscarriage of vision and legacy when batons are passed from one generation to the next. How can this problem be rectified, do you think?
All right. I think, Mike, I have the second hardest questions. You have the when it comes to legacies and batons, there's always certain things that are tough about that. I heard from one of my pastors, Pastor Paul, one time. He said if you're doing a relay race, and you want to really spoil the work of those who are doing the relay race, you don't look at the first person, look at the second person. You would just wait until the baton goes from the first person to the second person to the third person, and when it gets into the hands of the last person, find a way to trip up that last person, because if you can do that, then all the work of the first person, second, and third is wasted. I look at that when it comes to legacy and saying, okay, that's true. If our first generation fathers who have done great work, those who stand on their shoulders have gone far, what do we do next? It's important that we who are the next generation and those who are coming afterwards realize that there's a big weight on our shoulders, and we have to make sure that we keep the work going on, because if we trip up and we stop, then the work of all those who have gone before us is wasted. Now, how do we do that when it comes to the next generation? We must be deliberate about saying we've seen the work that must be done. Look at Nigeria when it comes to nation building, and I say Nigeria is a great, great giant with potential still waiting. Now, we have been called the giants of Africa for years, and this giant just refuses to stand up because the giant is still sitting down, looking around, waiting to move. And if we keep waiting to move, nothing will happen. We have to be deliberate about saying it's time for this giant to stand up. We have to be deliberate about saying it's time for us to invest into the human capital, as Dr. Obi said, of not just the population, but of people that are going to do great things. The rest of the world, Europe, North America, Canada, etc., the US, United States, are seeing our potential, and they are deliberately poaching our best minds to build their nations. And what are we doing about that here? So we begin to say, look, it's time for us to, as Dr. Cole said too as well, look inward deliberately and find those who have that potential. Begin to invest into them so that the work of all those who have gone before, like Your Excellency, is not wasted because there's no final generation to carry it on. We must be deliberate and say, okay, let's find a way to invest, find a way to look at who are we going to raise, because if the next generation is not successful in following what we have done, then we're not just success, but we are failure in disguise. What do we do then? We then begin to say, let's invest, let's be deliberate, let's look at where we want to be, that vision, where are we coming from, that history, like you were just saying, and say what needs to be that bridge between vision and history, and then invest to build that bridge. It's to find the young man, the young woman, and say, I deliberately want to get you to this future, and find a way so that when that baton is passed, the work of those who have gone before us is not wasted. His Excellency mentioned this morning about saying leaders must be deliberate about planting trees, not that we are going to sit under, but that our children will sit under. That's being deliberate. He mentioned that leaders must be deliberate in planting unity. It's important that we think along those lines, because when we think for the future, we see the past, we see the future where we want to go to, and then we say, how do we build a bridge between that past and that future? That's where the deliberate work comes in, so that the baton does not fall in the hands of the next generation, or else everything else will be wasted. But by God's grace, Nigeria's future is great. We are going to work on it, and it will not be wasted. I want to promise you, sir, your work will not be wasted. I want to promise every one of us, I want to promise Dr. Okunbo, by seeing his children and seeing all the work that you're doing, I know for sure that his work will not be wasted. And that is what we're proud of.
Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So I think we're going to wrap up now. I want to say a huge thank you to all of our panelists. Thank you, Dr. Obi. Thank you, Mr. Tony Cole. Thank you, Otto. Thank you, Bishop Feb. I hope that we've been able to touch on legacy and how we live legacy within political spheres, how we live legacy in entrepreneurship, how we live legacy through quality education, and also tips on practical tips from Bishop Feb on how to successfully transition from one generation to the other. So thank you so much for your time and being here. So I think the next segment is... Questions, okay. So we're going to open it up for some Q&A, and I think there's going to be a comment from His Excellency.
I'll hand him the mic.
Oh, you hand it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Your Excellency, President, good luck, Jonathan, and Your Royal Highness, and the great members of Okunbo family. I'm rushing to somewhere, so I pleaded for opportunity to say something. But first, to congratulate Okunbo children for keeping his legacy alive. And talking about legacy, and all of the things I've heard about education, you know, they say the power of example is. I mean, we don't need to search outside this room that we have such brilliant, beautiful children, boys and girls, all well-educated, living on their own, captain, taught us the power of example. And like people say, he could have decided, having made the kind of money he made in business legitimately, to buy houses for you across the world. But without investing in your education, you probably will be spending time now selling those houses to maintain a lifestyle that is not sustainable. So Captain taught us the value of investing, because what you don't do for your family, you can't do for community. The second, sir, is that we never appreciate anything in Nigeria. Even in this room, Mr. President, you left a legacy. Forget that I had cause to fight you politically, but that is what... No. But that is what politics is about. And the SSC also know that there was a question when even your own party members abandoned you, when you took a difficult decision, and I stood by you. However, you were who you are in your party, and I'm who I am in my party. But the power of example, the legacy you have laid, there is no successor who can afford to do less. That is to concede, that in a political office, even if you do the unthinkable, be an angel in politics, the logic of multi-party democracy, which you spoke to, is that even an angel can be defeated in an election. And that you considered it at the time Nigerians were truly afraid, where generals and bishops signed agreement to maintain peace, you didn't need anybody to call on you. And you made that historic call. That is a legacy that, however critical you are, I can't see a future Nigeria president wanting to question the judgment of Nigerians, whatever he thinks of himself. So you are an example of a leader who left something behind that nobody, that is the minimum standard now. And I'm sure by 2023 that will also play out. The second is that when I listen to all the talk about the power, the need for example, sir, I want to concentrate on this room because Nigeria, we quote people in America, people in Tanzania, people in Singapore. Here in Nigeria, there are good stories. There are good stories. Let's not dismiss everybody. Because the danger of dismissing everybody is that people will say, even President Jonathan, who considered defeat, what do they say about it? Do they remember? So I need to also amplify one of the things that you did that, by example, not by preaching, was when you launched the Almaziri School. And what was your objective? That no Nigerian child should be left roaming the street. And you appropriated federal funds in addition to the funds that were there for universal basic education. You appropriated special funds to reinforce that so that there shall be no child roaming the street like one of them mentioned. So the essence of what I'm saying is that these ideas are not new. What we like is the will to translate what we say into practice. And if we have done that, and I'm saying to our people that it's not too late now even to start. Like somebody said, if you wake up by 4 p.m., that is still your morning hour. You can do 8-hour job, provided you don't close before 12 midnight. So don't cry that you are late. And I think to you, you said so. Making mistake is not wrong. But people to be humble enough to acknowledge is even a statement in humility. So I want to appreciate Your Highness for coming, Majesty. Your Majesty for coming. I apologize for that, and the Queen. But also, sir, when I was told by the young man, my brother's son, that you will be coming to deliver lectures, you are going to see due to other exigencies. But you know, we never really know who our friends until we are no more. When a former president comes on stage to deliver the first lecture, and you say you came because of what he did while he was alive, many of us, before one is buried, we are abandoned. May you also be remembered for all the good things you've done, and people will travel from far and wide to acknowledge all of the things that you did. Now people will say, if he did so well, why did we not vote for him? That is politics. That is politics. And even more important, sir, is that I'm sure you have enjoyed the debate. Should Jonathan come back or should he stay? I'm sure you have felt very much fulfilled that nobody is appreciated until you leave the office. So, my sister, I want to congratulate you. I'm happy you are not spending all your life crying. You are trying to recognize that your father built a house, he built a legacy, and you have now the huge responsibility. You are not going to borrow his shoes, but you can even get better shoes. May the spirit of Captain Hosa continue to bring people together across political divide, across all those primordial sentiments that have detained Nigeria and inhibit our capacity to realize our huge potentials. God bless you all.
Thank you very much, Comrade, His Excellency Comrade Adams Oshiomole. Thank you, sir. At this point, we would like to take some questions from the audience. Because of the restriction of our time, we'd limit it to only 3 questions, and then we'll take it in 1 round.
Any questions from the audience?
Alhaji Tajuddin Umar Naba had indicated that he'd like to ask a question. Can I please find out where you're seated? Thank you, sir.
Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. I came all the way from Kano to honor this gathering and to say a few things about Captain. I heard about legacy that was said, and Captain Okunbo is a manifestation of that statement. Sorry, I want to recognize the former president, President Goodluck Jonathan, and His Royal Majesty, the Oluwafori. I went to the same secondary school with Captain Okunbo, the Federal Government College, Warri. I went all the way from Kano to Warri to school. Captain was there in 1975, and I joined in 1977. I didn't meet him in school, but when I was introduced to him, he took me as a brother. And up to the last, we maintained that relationship. Despite coming from Kano, I'm from a Muslim background, Captain never looked back. I became so close to members of his family, and mostly his junior brothers, Dandison, Morrison, Kenneth, and some of his children, Osahon, and others. Captain was a very, very good man. There was a time we were traveling to England together. I was in the economy class. Of course, he was in the business class. He invited me to the business class, and we sat together up to the end of the flight. I was so happy, and I felt honored. Captain is a very good man. I just have to leave whatever I'm doing to come and honor him. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Alhaji Tajuddin Umar Naba, Member Governing Body, Federal Institute of Industrial Research, Oshodi. We have a question here, and then I'll see if we have a question on the other side for the round of questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. I'm standing on existing protocol. My name is Cecilia Torishe Jupol. I'm the National Secretary of an Association of People that work to make people literate, meaning that all through this discussion, I have identified with everyone in who has also worked in similar areas. My question or my concern is that, could this be the beginning of a movement to bring like minds together, a movement to build a lasting legacy that will take Nigeria to where it should be? We do not want to remain a sleeping giant. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ma. We'll take one more comment. Or a question, actually. We'll just have a question. So if you have a question, please. Thank you.
All protocol duly observed. Ita Wilfred is the name. The question is to the panelists. Beautiful piece by everyone. So it's a very short one. How do this nation live off the shackles of rhetorics? We are so used to rhetorics in this country that every time we say things, it's just like we keep saying them. You all have beautiful renditions. So how do we live off these rhetorics? How do we practicalize these things that have been said?
Okay, thank you very much. That's just the one question for the panel. However, before I hand over to you, please, we have two comments in front, and then I'll hand the mic to you. Thank you. We have Honorable Ahmed Wadada, who would like to say something, and then Mr. Kingsley Okunbo.
Thank you very much. Mr. President, your dear loving wife, your majesty, and every person here. For me, I may not be wrong or be challenged by anybody that knew my relationship with the Okunbos. I can be addressed as Wadada Okunbo. I met Captain 26, 27, or 28 years back. I lived with him. And because Captain epitomizes what the Bible says, the book of Psalms says, it is neither about being a Jew or a Greek, a slave or a bona fide, but it is about those that call people to the ways of the Lord. Captain was a Nigerian. I lived with him as a Hausa man, a Muslim, and I had access to every part of the house. Morrison, Dandison, and I were in the same apartment. But to some extent, when Captain became his captain, we all know what that means. I had the privilege, I will be able and had the privilege to approach him under that circumstance much more than the two of them. One of the first most important things one does in life is to discover himself. I was able to discover myself. That's why I met Captain. But Captain rediscovered me. He rediscovered me because he left a legacy in me. What makes Wadada in Nigeria today is politics. How did I get there? After we had the transparent ballot boxes operation, which that means Captain contributed to the beginning of the Fourth Republic even before it came in, because the transparent ballot boxes were used to conduct the 1999 elections. And so Captain called me and said, Amadou. I said, sir, I have discovered something in you. The best of you will be in politics. So get ready. I'm sponsoring you to the House of Representatives. That was how I got to the House of Representatives and left a legacy as a member of the House of Representatives. Dino Bravo here can testify, and all Nigerians that lived. And on the generosity of Captain, Captain's generosity had no limit. Captain will call me and hold $100 note and say, Amadou, may the Lord never let us serve this. Let it continue to serve us to the end of our life. Because I knew and discovered, realized this level of generosity, anytime I was empty, I will go to the house and be frowning. He will call me, Amadou, why are you looking sad? I say, oh God, but you know now, you know what makes one happy. What makes one happy? I said, sir, my pocket is empty. Karim! So Captain lived a good life. Captain left legacies, and one of the legacies is here talking to you, Honorable Ahmed Wadada Aliyu. So I say to all that care to listen, I owe Captain three things. Prayers for God to reward him for the life he lived. Secondly, to look after what he has left behind and chip in my own contribution to the best of that he has left behind. And finally, to continue to relate, associate, and commit myself to whatever is Captain's. Thank you so very much for listening.
Thank you very much, sir. We have two more rounds of questions and then a comment from Senator Dino Melaye and Mr. Kingsley Okunbo. And then we will be rounding off this session of the Q&A and comments. So I'll come first. So I'll ask Honorable Razak Bello Osage has a question and a brief comment, followed by Captain's daughter, Ogogo Okunbo, who has a question. Then we'll move on to Senator Dino Melaye for a brief comment, and then we'll round off with Mr. Kingsley Okunbo with a comment, and then we'll go to the panel to respond. Thank you.
Your Excellency, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please, may I adopt the already established protocol? Razak Bello Osage is my name. A friend of this family, Okunbo family, for about four decades. Let me commend the siblings and the children of Captain Hosa for this initiative. We all listened to the main reason for this summit was to discuss the legacy that can move us forward in this country. Without any modicum of doubt, what is settled is that Captain Hosa Okunbo was quite accomplished as a professional and as a businessman. Investments in oil and gas, investments in marine security, in aviation, in hospitality. What else do you want to add? Very easily, in our own environment, definitively, Captain is seen and he resonates a locus classicus. Captain Hosa is a generational gift. One of the legacies that we talked about today is his investment in his children, his love for his family. That we appreciate very much. And I also want to say that I would like to refer to Captain from what we have heard, that Captain resonates a philanthropist in chief. That's what I would like to call him. And I want to thank the children. I want to thank Her Royal Highness Atuwashe III. I want to thank Osahon and your siblings for this initiative. But the appeal I want to make at this point is that you have started something. And what I see here is that you have brought the best people together to discuss. And we have been beneficiaries of the quality of discussion coming from the panel of discussants. My final appeal to all of us is that we all have a duty to sustain this Captain Hosa's legacy. Please let us remove all imaginary boundaries that will stop this fusion. If you are not going to be able to add any value to the unity of Captain Hosa's family, please stay away and pray for them. This is one appeal I want to make. May God bless you, all of us. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. So I'll move on to Miss Ogogo Okunbo.
Hello. firstly, I'd like to thank all of you guys for coming. It's been really nice listening to you guys speak. My first question is, from your career journeys, what advice would you give to the youth? And my second question is, we see a lot of youthful people going to abroad for education and things like that. From your personal opinion, do you think it is vital to be physically living in Nigeria to make a substantial change or not? Thank you.
Excellent. We'll move on to Senator Dino Melaye, then Mr. Kingsley Okunbo, then over to the panel.
To God be the glory forever and ever. Amen. The last productive president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. The Your Royal Majesty, ladies and gentlemen, I feel coming here and not saying a word about this one single Nigerian with multiple competences, great Nigerian, humanist by excellence, I will feel not fulfilled. Captain is one person I got to know through one of his business partners. But he became closer to me than anyone around him. First, the spirit of my mom will continue to appreciate Captain, because after my mom died, I built a chapel in our honor. And Captain said, "Dino, I will give you wood parquet to floor the entire church." Not only did Captain provided the wood floor, he provided for the installation, transport, and everything. He did everything there. Again, when I was doing my house in Metama, Captain came and said, "Come, I will also help. I have some wood materials from Texas. I'm going to bring them in for you." Captain brought installers and did every part of that house free. And he will come on his own to come and supervise what they are doing. I've never seen a Nigerian like that. When it was time for Edo election, Captain is aware that I'm in PDP. He's in APC. But he accommodated me in Benin and paid for all my stay in Protea Hotel throughout the election period, despite the fact that we are not on the same political page at that time. And I can say that Captain is so generous, so kind. He was in London in his sick bed. After the election, he traveled. I was running for something in Kogi. Captain still sent money. Just a few weeks before he passed on, sent money. I think I saw the young man here. He normally, anytime I see that guy from Captain, I just said, I want to see him all the time. You know, because anytime I see him in my house, I know there's a message. He sent me money. So that is the type of man we are celebrating here today. And I prophesy, and my singular prayer is this, that all his children will be older than him in Jesus' name. And by the special grace of God, you will do greater things than your father. I celebrate this man, and I want, please, to the family, I will want to be part of everything that have to do with Captain. He's a good man, he died a good man, and by the grace of God, at the resurrection hour, we will see again. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Senator Odinumilaye, and we'll come to Mr. Kingsley Okunbo.
Mr. President, sir, my distinguished royal fathers, distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm sure my children, starting from Osaho, will be saying this day, Daddy said so. Why am I saying that? They will very much remember something that my brother usually told them. He said, look, I don't owe you anything. What I owe you is education and my name. Since my brother died, that day, I don't think if you took a knife, a blunt one for that matter, to cut my hand, the pain would be anything compared to how I felt seeing him go. And it goes to show that, just like they say, like one philosopher said, that legacy is not what you leave for people, it's what you leave in them. It is not the inheritance. There's a big difference. I'm glad and healed most of the time when I think of my brother, when I hear what people say about him. It is not what he gave, what they say about the impression he left in their minds. That is why I tell them, my children, that look, the greatest gift and the greatest legacy you can take from your father is not the material things you see. It is one thing that everybody has said about him, which is love, kindness, embellished in goodwill and love for people. That is the greatest legacy he left. And one thing too that gladdened me, Pastor Feb, Dr. Feb, you know, Miles Moreau, he said, we should disappoint the grave and go there empty. I saw my brother go. He disappointed the grave. He went empty. He emptied himself. And for that reason, no matter how pained I am, anytime I think about him, I rejoice. Because I know that for a fact. He left a legacy of love for family above every other thing. Captain can never hear that there's anything wrong with any member of the family and business comes first. No, it is family first before any other thing. And that is what I've tried to preach to everyone, that family comes first. Sometimes when we do different things every day, I want to believe that we are writing our legacy. Everything they say about Captain, sometimes I sat down, I said, where did he get these attributes from? And sorry, I just knew him not too long. I only knew him for 59 years. My grandmother, we're talking about kindness now. I had a grandmother that Captain grew up with. He loved to stay with my grandmother. Please let me not bore you too much. My grandmother was one of the kindest people I've ever met. She was the businesswoman of the house. You go to her when you don't have money. And there was this funny thing we always laugh with. Anytime you go to her, before you ask her, where will I get the money from? That money never belonged to her. It always belonged to somebody else. Then she will now tell you, when you are about to go, okay, how much did you say you needed? Everybody comes to borrow that money. And say, she will say it in Benin. This one is not forever. You must bring that money back. They will say, okay. They will borrow that money and go. They will come back the next week. She would say the same thing. She would give the same money. She could never say no to anybody. And Captain grew up with her. She imbibed that. He imbibed that, sorry. My father was an educator. He was a headmaster. He was an administrator of schools. During the Civil War, my father, they were the ones paying teachers. And I remember a statement he made. He said, look, I am not rich. I know what happened to people of my mate that did certain things. My father was one of those that swore that he would never use dead men's salary to train his children. He returned the salaries of dead teachers, during the Civil War. That is the stock Captain is from. So I just want to give that little background. So I'm really grateful on behalf of the family for this distinguished panel and for our president and everyone that has come to honor this family. And now coming to the topic of the day, when I saw this and having listened to all of you, please, for me, I'm a young man. You know, when I look at, like Josa have said, if it is true, like they say, that there is a difference between legacy and inheritance, Nigeria is blessed with so much. We inherited so much. Human resources, some oil, gold, everything. Could it be that even for the fact that, yes, our forefathers, our nationalists, they didn't really give us a good example, just like our president said, everybody was clannish. You are thinking of your region. But God, in his own infinite mercy, probably gave us a little glimpse of what we can take and run with and unlock the potential that we have. And I want to believe, I might be wrong, anytime I listen to our old anthem that says, though tribe and tongue may differ, in brotherhood we stand. If we are to imbibe just that, probably today there will be honesty. There won't be corruption. There won't be insecurity, because you will look out for your brother. You won't care wherever that person comes from. We will think of Nigeria first, and I'm sure this country will be better for it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we're now going to take the questions. So the first one was from the gentleman in the back. How can we move from rhetoric to pragmatism? So I'm going to come to Bishop Febb for this one.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that was a great question about moving from rhetoric. For me, the answer to that one is simple, because you must begin from rhetoric. Rhetoric is very important. You have to speak first. If you don't speak first, then no one will listen to you and see what you're doing. So the problem in Nigeria is that we like to talk, but after talking, we don't do anything. So here's my suggestion for us. I think we have to speak and then take action. My father would always tell us, he would say to us, he said, stop cursing NEPA. Go and turn on your generator. In other words, stop talking and talking and talking. Go and do something about what the problem is. So my answer for that is, look at this panel here. Everyone here on this panel has used rhetoric, but then they are doing something. Here's the first one. Dr. Obi used rhetoric. She spoke. The world listened. And after they listened, she began doing something. Bring Back Our Girls is one of them. Transparency International is one of them. You can go on and on and on that she moved from rhetoric to action. Tonya Cole here used rhetoric. He spoke, but then he didn't just speak only. He took action. He started an energy company and literally turned on power for us, not just in by speaking literally, figuratively. But then he also began to mentor young men and young women to do what he was doing. That's doing rhetoric and then taking action. Otto used rhetoric. He spoke that there's a problem with education with our young people. And then he took action. He quit his job and then began to find young men, young women, and train them to go to school. So rhetoric is important. My wife and I, my wife is here, beautiful, beautiful woman over there, my lovely wife, she's here. We speak about what we see, but we started many schools to train young men and young women to do what needs to be done. My point is very simple, that rhetoric is important. We must speak, but after speaking, we must take action. Thank you very much. Captain Hosa spoke many times, but as you were saying just now, he didn't just speak only. He would put action behind what he was doing. So that is what you must do. If you want to see Nigeria change, we must speak and then use education. Our university is one of them. We must make sure that people understand there is a difference. And to build that bridge from history to action, we must take action. We must do something. So in conclusion, I would say this. Rhetoric is important, but if all of us don't do our part by lighting our candle where we are, nothing will happen. So Nigerians talk a lot. We must then go from speaking to doing something. If we have one light there, a second light there, a third light and a fourth light, a fifth light, a sixth light, you are taking what the money you have and helping entrepreneurs. These are small lights. But if you bring all these small lights together, we move beyond rhetoric, and it's the action that will change this country. That's my answer.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So our next question is from my beautiful sister, Ogogo. What is the advice to the youth and advice on their career journey as they think about building legacy? Who wants to take this one? Mrs. Obi, Dr. Obi. No, that was the second one. So this is the first question. So advice to our youth in their career as they're thinking about building their legacy.
Oh, you ask such splendid questions.
She's the brains of the family. Retired.
I could see that. I think that a critical thing for any African child today is the understanding that they are not hobbled by the albatross of colonialism, of militarism that we had when we were growing up. In fact, democracy is not something we grew up with as a generation. And you know, that has a problem. The concept of accountability, the concept of the strength to irreverentially ask systems to be accountable, your generation knows it better. Our generation was taught to see no evil, know no evil, and speak no evil. And so if you made the mistake of being the one who spoke of evil that you saw, you were definitely not going to be friends with anyone. But your generation, you're larger in number in understanding that you can dare the systems when they don't respond to the particular responsibility that they owe under the social contract as a theory. So that's one. Number two is, you are growing in a world that is so integrated. The standards cannot be the Nigerian standard. The reason that I look at people and I say, how much they miss it. Wow. So you are okay with the Nigerian standard. It means that you are capped. Because any standard beyond the Nigerian standard would not accept the minimalism that you carry on with in Nigeria. In the external standard, in the global standard, values, and that's one word that we have not really emphasized. We've scattered around it. But the real thing that we've been discussing, ladies and gentlemen, all through today, is about values. You can't be talking about legacy with distorted values. So when I listen to Kingsley speak about his brother, I'm suddenly sort of connecting the dots. And I'm saying there was a grandmother who personified certain attributes. Genetically, environmentally, things began to travel between generations. One of the things you wanted us to talk about was intergenerational conversations. In those moments that he spent with his grandmother, you can imagine the conversations that happened. Mama would have said things like, even if we don't have money, we have our values. A child hears that, it never leaves. I grew up with a dad that said to me, we may not be rich in money, but we're wealthy in values. It never left me. I grew up with a father who said to me, you can negotiate your views when superior argument is put before you, or facts hitherto unknown to you are presented to you, but you must never negotiate your values. Because the day you negotiate your values, you're gone. Maybe you're alive, but you're dead. My father said that character, integrity, is not complete until it is consistent. These are values. Okunbo represented that at different levels. So the different people he interacted with saw values. That's the basis of legacy. That's when rhetorics will not be enough. Because the Chinese say, what you're doing is so loud, I can't hear what you're saying. Huh? You know, so we need to understand that what you have gathered us to do today is not simply to have a one-year lecture. Hey, former president attended it. It is really that as we have sat here and listened, each of us would go away and we would then say to ourselves, what did I take away from this? What is it about sustainability that I need to implant into the way that I'm now living my life? Even if 10% of us would live here with a sense of redirection of our priorities, because that's another word that we've been skirting around. Captain Hosa prioritized education. He simply said, investing in people, whether they are from Kano or they are from Sokoto or wherever else, for as long as I can invest in them, they would appreciate. What are the two key problems that the continent must solve economically? Productivity and competitiveness. Where do these two things come from? From the investment in your human beings. So we have a man who, by virtue of all that we've been listening to, has shaped a certain direction of thinking that we must all live with. And my final set of points to you is that it means that your competitiveness, your productivity is what earns you your reward for your generation. For the generation that we are and the ones before us, productivity and competitiveness really didn't connect to being a billionaire. Your generation, you can't be a billionaire without a source. We must trace where it came from, because that's when you will be globally recognized and celebrated. You don't want to be a Nigerian billionaire. You want to be a globally recognized billionaire. And your generation is a generation of incredible. Are you a Gen Z? The world will be fixed by the Gen Zs. When parents can't hear, Gen Z will open their ears by force. Because Gen Zs cannot be bothered to be restrained by anything that is trying to hold them back. The eclecticism of their knowledge and their ideas, their capacity to innovate and create, is just unbelievable. I have great confidence in Gen Z generation in this country. You can see them already now. They just take over and they just define the rules of the game, literally. So I want to encourage you to see that even for those who have the capacity, if they have earned their wealth and they choose to give foreign education to their children, all that I pray for is that we should be more productive as a society. If we're more productive as a society, the household income of many more people will increase. They would have better options in terms of decisions they are making concerning their children. So if that decision includes using well-earned money to train them abroad, then that's fine. But we cannot have a situation where our elite, elite like this, are comfortable to disconnect populations. So the population of the children of the elite have the topmost quality of education, and then 85% of the rest of the population have poor quality education. We're creating the seeds of implosion. The ones that we have educated so expensively do not have a lasting basis for survival in a city or in a country called Nigeria. And that means that it is in the self-interest of Africa's elite to stop being selfish. Selfishness will kill the African elite, ultimately. because resilience of society cannot withstand. Moderator, forgive me, but I thought that we now entered the real conversation that we came here to have. The resilience of the society cannot withstand the level of political rascality that we see in Africa, where leadership is for self instead of it being for the common good. We can't continually subordinate the interest of a few, the interest of the larger population to the interest of a few. It's a distortion. It's an anomaly. We must correct it. And that's where, when you talk about rhetorics not being enough, rhetorics are not enough. So number one, have you gotten your PVC? That's an action. Number two, would you go out and vote and defend your vote and not go anywhere? Number three, would you stop being the middle class that think that just because you can get an economy ticket to London, you have passed every other person? Therefore, you don't care about society. If government works or does not work, you don't care. Let me tell you, based on the recent research I did, every one of you and me were just three cousins away from poverty. Three cousins away from poverty. So all these lifting, so what do they call that? You know? It won't work for us for too long. The society is no longer resilient. It will crumble if we continued with this level of selfishness of our political class. I have a particular problem with Africa's political class. The other continents where you have seen a transition from underdevelopment to development, it took a deliberate and intentional focus of the energy of the political class to say that we must build a society where everybody can thrive. And that's what the Okunbos brought us here to speak about. Let me end on the note that what you said, you talked about knowledge, you talked about education, and you talked about a name. And then I said, we've been skating around a third thing, values. You know, the reason that I can connect to that is that my dad said, I don't have landed assets to hand over to you and your siblings. But one thing that I know is that I'm giving you three things. I'm giving you my name. I'm giving you education, the most that my money can get. And then I'm giving you values. You see all those sayings that I've been saying, my dad said this, my dad said that. Those were important. So he said, these three things will take you far. Have I not come far? So for those of you who constantly are thinking, how am I going to do it? It can be done. My dad did not compromise himself for a second. And he was a public servant in this land. With a hardworking mom, they could work together to give these three things that I just said. And he said, it will take you far. And it's taking us far. So this idea of getting, you know, there's a scripture in the Bible that says, just like a partridge sits on an egg and cannot hatch it, so a man or a woman who goes and acquires wealth by crooked means will soon depart from them, and at the end of it, they will be known as fools. There are too many fools in our country today because they are choosing to be like a partridge. But I'm begging us that if it is only to honor Captain Okunbo, not just to talk about him, we should reflect a bit. Reflect and say to ourselves, how do we redirect this society for the sake of the poor? The poor have hoped and begged for too long, and we just carry on. We must not do so. And finally, I think your grandmother must have been the elder sister of my mom. On that thing you said about, give me money, and she says, it's not my money. I'm keeping it for somebody. And yet she would give it to you. That was my perfect mom. So I come back, yeah, precisely. You know, there's nothing like that kind of motherhood. Now I can understand how it was that a great personality like Okunbo was in our midst. I bless your family once again, and I thank you for the opportunity of coming to spend this Saturday afternoon with you. May the Lord be with you all and continue to lead you on the journey to greatness. God bless you all.
On that note, I think that's the end of our panel discussion. So thank you so much, Dr. Obi. Thank you, Mr. Cole. Thank you, Otto. Thank you, Bishop Febb. I think everyone is going to go away from this and think about what they're doing in their lives to contribute to legacy. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much. May we please ask that you remain on stage just to stand for a picture opportunity. Thank you for all the panelists and the moderator. Thanks. Yes. May we please invite Mr. President, His Excellency, Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan to join them on stage for photos. Thank you. We will still have time for pictures afterwards. This is just with the panel. We're gradually coming to the end of today's lecture, and once we are done, we'd please like to ask our dignitaries to stay behind for pictures with the family. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think our panelists deserve another round of applause as they take their seats. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Obi Ezekwesili. Thank you, Mr. Tonya Cole. Thank you, Bishop Feb Ida Hosa. Thank you, Mr. Otto Orondam. Really, really grateful for your time and sharing so extensively on the topic this afternoon. Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we have only a few more things to get through on the item of today's program. We thank you for spending your afternoon with us. We're really grateful that you've been with us since the beginning of today's lecture, and in a few minutes, we will be wrapping things up. At this point, I'd like to invite on stage to give a remark about legacy, the Royal Father of the Day for today's lecture, His Royal Majesty, Ogeame Atuwase III, the Olu of Wari. Ogeame Suo, he'll come to give a remark on today's theme of legacy. A round of applause, please, as our Royal Father of the Day comes to the podium. Thank you.
Thank you. My thoughts and words are going to be scattered. I came here with some notes, but I have made so many alterations, so I apologize ahead of time. But we'll get there. Your Excellency, always a pleasure. It's good to see you too. Your Excellency, always a pleasure to see you. My brother, the Dean of Agbo, always a pleasure. And earlier you had said, the MC had said, my wife is wearing two caps. So I celebrate her in both capacities. Tonya and Adesua, you both spoke about the name and the power of the name and how it has opened doors for you. Something came to my mind when you mentioned names, opening doors. Many examples about myself, but the one who blows the trumpet ahead of me today told me a story a couple of years ago. He said it in passing. I don't even think he realized I paid attention to what he said. And he said he found himself in Mina many years ago when my father was alive. And he decided to try his luck and took Okada to Hilltop Mansion, IBB's residence, and decided to be bold to say a prince from Warri Kingdom is at the gate. My father did not send him, and believe it or not, the gates were open to him, and he left Hilltop Mansion with some dollars. This was before we started clamping down on fraudulent behavior, so he was very lucky. Feb, you spoke about shoes. And this resonates with me in terms of style. I actually did give the specific example to a family that came to see me when their patriarch had just passed on. And I said to them, he was able to achieve a lot and now his shoes are too big to fill. Don't try to fill those shoes. What I want you to do is take those shoes, frame them, and be inspired, cut your own, so that you are able to better walk around in your own shoes. Feb, you also spoke about relay race and how you don't want the person running the fourth leg to be sabotage the efforts of everybody who has gone ahead of you. I remember I was quite the athlete when I was younger, for those of you who do not know. I could run, and we would always strategize. And we knew of the four of us, the slowest person, relatively, we would always put him in the second leg. And for whatever reason, it worked. And I think this speaks to all of us playing to our individual and collective strengths. Because ultimately, we are only as fast as the slowest person on our team. And where ego wants to, or selfishness wants to go ahead, we always need to call that to question, call that to order. So now going into it, what is legacy? And I jokingly remarked, something one is more than likely never to see. It is the opening of one's eyes, it is the opening of eyes and minds so that they can see differently. As we spoke about Nigeria, I had penciled this last night and I wasn't sure if I would go into it, but with the way the conversation flowed, I think it's important I speak on something that I did not coin. I heard it many years ago. I cannot remember who I should credit it to, but it's not the terminology of it is not original to me. And it is the Esau syndrome. We all know the story of Esau and Jacob. Esau literally ate his destiny. He ate seed that he should have planted. This has become prevalent in Nigeria today, where a very popular response you hear from all manners of people. Now that one I want chop. Who that one help? And those responses are usually to ideas. They are usually to suggestions that would actually build in the long term. But everybody only cares for the now. And thus, we glorify stomach infrastructure. The stomach has become the order of the day. It used to be the pocket, but now it is the stomach. And this has gone down to the grassroots of our society. And it's not just in the political or economic or social centers of power, even down to spiritual and traditional power centers. People do not hesitate to cross that line between the sacred and the profane for the sake of their own stomach. And once that line is crossed, it's easy for the rest to just fall without much resistance. And this is what has plagued us as a nation, the Esau syndrome, eating the seeds we ought to sow, simply because there is no vision. They cannot see. They may blame it that Nigeria has done so much to them, they are discouraged, whatever they want to blame it on, they simply cannot see. And thus, because they cannot see, there is no hope. And it's down to raw survival. Which is why we are where we are as a nation today. The culture, the toleration, the attitude, it fosters an environment that escalates grievances and creates social chaos. And before we know it, we are in a culture of deception. And there is no peace where there is no trust. And there is no trust where there is no truth in words. Which is why it's easy for not just politicians, anyone really, to just say something. And they don't believe in what they are saying, just simply so they can get something into their hands or their stomachs. While it is very human for us to want to see immediate results, the real lasting legacy doesn't kick in until that seed has fallen, died, or departed. And yes, I had mentioned I would want to make a distinction, and everybody has made that distinction already, between an inheritance and legacy. True legacy is about the greater good that must outlive one's lifetime. For those who attain it, there is an element of destiny, as well as an element of discipline and determination. Seizing every opportune moment with such consistency that it amalgamates into a movement. And ultimately, that movement will become a mindset shift. And that mindset shift ultimately will result in a shift in culture. Mr. President, former Governor Adams Oshiomhole beat me to it, speaking about the legacy you have left. And I want to reiterate it again, because sometimes I don't think people really understand what it is when you are soaked in a culture, a political culture at the time, which in Africa, strong man does not leave, he stays. Anything we want to happen, make it happen. And I felt you literally broke through. And this is because, and I say this with all serious, with all humility, with all with respect. Being of the Ijaw extraction, there is an injustice that has been done in the way Ijaws are perceived. Very forceful people. They're not agree. Their blood is hot. And that is the environment in which you grew up in. And that nature could have come alive in you, and you could have said, after all, I'm not agree. I am the president. But you walked away from that. And you had access to the apparatus of the state in typical African fashion. You could have rigged it, let the heavens fall. And ultimately, Nigerians being what they are, they would have accepted. But you showed us that it is possible. And I believe that was a kind of death that thing in you died, and that was what caused your legacy to be birthed. So now I go back to my original notes. As I said, I would be a bit scattered. And attaining this is never easy, because great men who have truly achieved in this life, there is a temptation that comes their way. A temptation that wants them to settle for the real-time success they enjoy. And this is because there is no shortage of people lining up to embellish their elegance and their eloquence, constantly telling them, Baba, it's not easy to make money like this. You have done well. You have done well. And there are many Nigerians who have done well. But once they die, there's not much celebrated in terms of legacy. Some of them even go about it in their own wisdom and their own energy to launder their own image, which fades away once they are no longer buoyant or have passed away. And this brings me back to the year 2010, and I pulled Tonya's leg. I am very happy to see Tonya today, because I was part of the trainee program that his company, Sahara, did. And I remember when Tonya, Tokpe, Kola, and they spoke to about 15, 20 of us, and they asked us a question, which till today I still look around to see, is there an answer? And this was in terms of business legacy. They said, how many Nigerian-owned businesses can you count that have survived the proprietor's death? And we were all there in the room naming some names, and they were quickly telling us, is it where the proprietor left it? And the answer was no. And we were trying to defend it, saying, well, it's because their wealth was tied to politics, or there's no power generation in Nigeria, they were into manufacturing. So many excuses. But ultimately, that really opened our eyes to see that for whatever reason, we suffer from a culture of good legacy in our business world, even in our political sphere. And I am very happy to see, and what they had said to us on that day was that they intended that Sahara would be the Shell of Africa. That they would be able to walk away from this company, not because they were old, and that they would not force their children, who maybe don't have any interest in the company, to say that you must fill our shoes, but that they would hire competent people to continue this hard work that they had started, and their children would still benefit from it anyways. And that is something that has never left my mind. And I'm happy to see that, obviously I know Tonya has walked away from active management of the company, and as well as a couple of the others, and it is still thriving. And by the grace of God, what you had said about it being the Shell of Africa, it will happen. And also, I say this without bias, that the group of companies that Captain has left behind also, they will even surpass the levels to which he took it. So I thank you all today, and I really pray that as Nigerians, we will be willing to rid ourselves of that Esau syndrome. And I think that former president demonstrating that it is possible to die to what the flesh and the culture is dictating to you, staring at you, roaring in the face that this is how you must do it. But he stood back and said, no, I can do it differently. All of us as Nigerians, the hardships that make us
constantly think this is the only way we should respond to situations. And this is part of what keeps us in this cycle. We will break free from those holding patterns and surge and move forward. God bless you all.
Thank you very much. Father of the day, a true father in every sense of that word, for wrapping up the conversation so fittingly. Thank you very much. His Royal Majesty, Ogeame Atuwase III, the Olu of Warri Kingdom. We also I'd like to mention at this point that we have members of the Shekiri community in Abuja. They've come in their numbers to support today's lecture. Can you just wave if you're in the room, would like to honor you and acknowledge. Thank you very much for coming. We're coming to the end of today's lecture, and I'm sure you'd agree with me that it has been a truly impactful, insightful, and engaging day. But before we go, we have two more things to do, and then we will call it an afternoon. I'd like to invite on stage to give a brief poetry recitation, one of Captain's daughters, Miss Osamuwese Okunbo. A round of applause, please, as she comes on stage. Can we please sustain the applause and encourage her as she comes to take the mic to recite the poem?
So the poem I'm reciting today is called Holding the Fort. Within the earth's beautifully textured greenery and the clear sky's scenery, the constancy of my voice has remained, age-long wisdom explained. Do not lose sight of your heritage, I exclaim. Distractions and distortions you must tame. For you who have risen to heights today must make room for others to build upon the foundations you lay. That in the fullness of time, when what was once my vision becomes yours, you shall, with every sense of continuance, groom the progenitor's vine in a behemoth of generational sustenance that soars. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Osamuwese Okunbo. Please, let's give her another round of applause. Thank you. Don't worry. The quota of applause we've used today is almost over. We're almost done. So just finish it on us this afternoon. Thank you very much. Thank you, Osamuwese. Thank you so much for that poem. And now to invite another one of Captain's children. As we've said again and again today, she is not just here in the capacity of being Captain's daughter, she's also here as a distinguished member of society in Nigeria. To give the vote of thanks this afternoon, I'd like to invite to the podium Olori Atuwase III, the wife of the Olu of Warri Kingdom.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you all so much. His Excellency, good luck, Jonathan. Thank you so, so much for being here. Mommy Patience, Dame Patience, good luck, Jonathan. Thank you very much. His Majesty, Ogeame Atuwase III, the Olu of Warri. His Majesty, the Dane of Agbo. Esteemed guests here present, thank you all so much for being present today at the Memorial Summit in honor of our beloved father. You know, so much was said here today, and I had a beautifully written vote of thanks, but I don't think I will do it justice if I don't really begin to talk about some of the things or some of the points that were made by the panelists and by our keynote speaker on legacy. My father was a visionary leader, but he was also a patriot in every sense of the word. He loved Nigeria. As much as he sent all of us abroad to school, at least for the first three of us that he had the benefit of seeing us graduate. Immediately after school, I studied, I would speak for myself personally, I studied law in England. And immediately after my law degree, my father said, yeah, pack your bags. You're going to go and do law school in Nigeria. There's nothing for you in this foreign country. And he ensured I packed my bags because I didn't want to come. But that was because I believe he saw something in this country that most people don't. He saw hope. He saw possibility. He saw a potential future that speaks true to us as the giants of Africa. And so he didn't just invest in his children going abroad to study. He ensured that they came back to implement the study in the country that they come from. And I'm standing here as a living testimony of that. And I'm very thankful that I came back. There's a popular saying that says that if you want to build a name for yourself, invest in great projects. But if you want to build a legacy, then invest in people using different means, including great projects. And we see that Captain Hosa was a keen investor. From many of the things that had been spoken from his burial and up until now, every time we gather to honor him, there is just one word, one person, one more. And I was sitting there, I was like, goodness gracious me, how could one man do so much? He invested his life in people, not just in his children. He invested it in his community in Benin and Edo State, as we can see the testament of. We only thought that, you know, it was going to be a small gathering of us there on Monday. The hall was full to overflowing just because of the goodwill that he had through investing in people. We see the same in his alma mater and his past institutions. And I dare say even in this nation, Nigeria at large, by virtue of what His Excellency President Goodluck testified of today. And so with that being said, today is truly a dream come true for me, because it attests to the validity of my father's vision. People want to build legacy. We understand that it's important to build legacy. And the truth is, when we say legacy, we oftentimes think legacy is going to be the, you could build a good legacy or you could build a bad legacy, right? So legacy isn't just a word that is meant for positivity. We were sat here and we spoke about legacy in terms of positive change, but there's also bad legacy in terms of negative change. And I want to implore every single person here today to go away inspired, but also transformed by the vision to build positive legacy, first beginning in your families, and then your communities, and then the wider, you know, your wider spheres of influence. At this juncture, it is with great honor that I would like to announce, on behalf of my family, the launch of the Wells Hosa Okunbo Foundation. This foundation is an expression of his undying legacy, established primarily to consolidate and to continue his passionate commitment to raising world changers in the core areas of education, entrepreneurship, and youth empowerment in Nigeria. Through this outfit, we are determined to revolutionize the face of industrialization on the continent of Africa by promoting indigenous innovations that can boldly make a mark in the global space. The necessary systems for deployment are currently evolving, and in the near future, I'll be reaching out to many people in this room for continued funding. The dreams of the African child, as we sat here and all our panelists rightly said, are valid, and we are poised to release the momentums for these dreams to take flight. We look forward to working with institutions such as the Slums to School, Human Capital, and many more to see
the legacy of Captain Hosa become established. A special thank you to our keynote speaker once again, His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Abella Jonathan, for his holistic presentation and contribution to the subject matter. A very, very special thank you to our father of the day, Ogyame Atuashe III, the Olu of Wari, for such insightful words on legacy and legacy creation. A big thank you to all our esteemed panelists, Mr. Tonya Cole. Thank you very much for giving us such insightful words on the name and the weight of the name and how it opens doors. Thank you very much. Dr. Obi Ezekwesili, as you spoke, I fell in love with you more and more and more and more. I didn't think it was possible, but I did. Thank you so much for honoring my invitation last minute, dare I say. She honored it just yesterday and decided that she was going to be here with us. Thank you so much. Thank you for provoking us. Thank you for causing us to burn again with vision and with insight on what truly matters, which is human capital and investing in the next generation. Mr. Otto Orendam, this is my first time meeting you, but thank you. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for the work that you do with Slum to School. I look forward to working with you even in a more personal capacity. Bishop Dr. Feb Idahosa, a friend and a dear brother to us in the family. I don't know if he's still here. I believe he stepped out. Thank you very much for coming and for your insightful words and ensuring that we make our own shoes, you know, and plant more mango seeds. To our very own moderator, Adesua Okunbo Rhodes, thank you so much for contributing your voice to this profound discussion. And to each and every single person here that came and took time out of their busy schedules to honor our invitation and to listen, thank you for your presence. Please give yourselves a round of applause. I value all of you so dearly. Thank you. And until we meet again next year, God bless you and good afternoon.
Thank you very much, Olori Atuashe III, the wife of the Olu of Wari Kingdom. Thank you very much indeed for such a great rounding off of today's conversation. And so, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, your excellencies, family members, friends, all our loved ones, thank you all for coming this afternoon, from morning actually, until now afternoon. We're really grateful for your time. And would like to ask all our special guests to kindly wait. Would like to take pictures with you alongside the family members. And for every other person, thank you for coming. Have a good afternoon. And like Olori said, see you next year. Thank you. All right, may we please invite His Excellency? May I please invite all the Okunbo children and His Excellency to Goodluck Abella Jonathan for the first set of pictures. Thank you. All Captain Hosa Okunbo's children here present and
His Excellency Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan and Dame Patience Jonathan. I'd also like to invite His Royal Majesty Ogeame Atuwase III, the Oluwawori, to join the picture.